No effing way.
Guys, I'm sorry that we didn't do this earlier because it's totally my fault. I got a bit of a cold. Yeah. But we're here with a very special program.
I got one of those things called a job this week.
Oh, Jesus.
I'm not really prepared. I've been kind of busy this week.
It's all right.
Get a little prepared.
But we're trying. We're here. We're here now, and that's what's important.
That's what matters.
Yeah. We'll be back next week with notes, for sure.
Yeah.
with
notes. What's so special about today?
Well, no, it's just, you'll see. It's very good. It's coming up. It's coming up very, very shortly.
You know how much I hate and love surprises.
Yeah. It's that love and hate thing. But yeah. China was last week.
Yep.
Very exciting Grand Prix.
Yeah, you guys are going to have to explain to me because I thought we were going to watch it together.
Yeah, but see, then I went and got sick.
That's what I thought too.
Yeah. I'm sorry, guys.
And then you guys watched it on your own independently.
Yeah. Well, I had to.
My week's a mess. Like, my whole watching experience was shit too. Like, I saw up to lap 41 where there was that sort of slide corner by Maldonado. And I was like, all right, I had to go to do some shit. So I turned it off.
I gotta do some laundry.
that was the second half.
some bachelor stuff.
Yeah.
But it was a very exciting race. I mean, a quick recap. Raikkonen did one of the best starts that I've ever seen him do.
Oh,
he overtook two by the second corner.
Woo.
Yeah, the two Williams.
That whole start was pretty intense.
Yeah,
this week.
The whole start was awesome.
It was so tight.
Towards the end, though, Max Verstappen, the young guy,
yeah,
his car broke down after an impressive performance for him.
Oh,
he pulled some like incredible overtakes the entire
whole season so far. It's,
yeah,
he's pretty good, man.
Oh, like Martin Brundle, the top UK commentator was like, yo, I'm seeing some Schumacher stuff here.
Oh,
I'm seeing
fuck.
Some Senna stuff with this kid. Yeah.
Wait, how old is he?
Like 17.
17.
Fuck, man.
17.
Every time he does something crazy too, they cut the, I don't know, they must be just the guy that's assigned to stand there and film his dad.
Yeah.
So every time something crazy happens, they show his dad and he's like
displeased.
I don't know if he's displeased. He may be a little jealous, but he should be proud. He's standing there staring at the TV. Like, they show him like this. He's got his headphones on. He's just like,
yeah, that's my son.
That's it. Yeah.
When I was 17, I was like watching Dragon Ball Z.
doing nothing
with my life.
I've never seen an episode, but
no, and that's really the thing, man. Everybody,
I wasn't a fucking racing superstar, that's for sure.
Yeah. And he has proven to be very, very mature. Now, I mean, when they introduce the rules, because like right after he joined, like, now no more 17-year-olds, are saying at least 18.
Yeah.
I think there was a concern about how mature he might or might not be.
Yeah.
But he's proven that at least he himself is very mature for a 17-year-old. Like, I would have been nowhere. I mean, come on, 17, remember? Like, you remember 17?
Yeah.
I was an idiot at 17.
Yeah.
Still am, but I was
a lot of what he says makes sense, though, that he grew up sort of in the paddock with his dad, seeing his dad talking to cameras all the time and cameras around,
knows how to handle
microphones
that sort of thing.
Everywhere.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah.
That's great.
He grew up with that. What else happened? Like I was saying last week, I was waiting because you were talking shit about Vettel's performance against Raikkonen. I was waiting for him to not crash.
Yeah.
And fight a race, and that's what happened.
They
had to fight right to the end.
They were very close. And yeah, some say that if Raikkonen had a couple more laps.
Yeah.
Because the thing is that once Verstappen stopped, he stopped on the start finish straight.
Yeah, not if he had a few more laps.
So
Renault was a little more.
They had to call in the safety car. So the race ended under the safety car. So nobody could overtake.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that kind of like. But despite that, I think China was like so far, like the best race so far.
Oh, really?
It screwed up my fantasy. Picks too, because apparently before this race there was only one safety car ever in China, I think, and this was the second one on the last three laps. I predicted zero on Badger. It popped up, screwed up everything. But to be honest, I'm happy because there was a fight, and I think it would have come down like on the last few corners. Raikkonen would have been like this behind Vettel, like in his ass.
It would have been awesome. Ooh.
He's getting close. So Vettel kind of like wore his tires a bit, trying to catch Rosberg, which I guess it wasn't gonna happen.
Oh man, and Nico Rosberg was such a pussy. he was such a little bitch.
Last year I was already like, what? I'm a Hamilton fan since I first saw him in 2007 or whatever. But man.
Are they talking shit? I feel like that's all they do in F1.
Nico Rosberg, like this year, he's been just...
as a little baby.
Hamilton's hilarious, though, man. He's just laughing him off. Last year, you could see he was getting a little, like... he had too much on his mind, and he was fighting. Like, he's the champion now. He's just whatever.
Whatever. Everything bounces off. That complete change of attitude, I respect Hamilton a lot more than I did last year, for sure.
When you see them on the conferences or talking and stuff, Hamilton's just like, you know, like this. And Rosberg's face, he's like got a little scowl on. He's always still still sweating. His eyes all red. Maybe that's from stress, his eye problem.
Yeah,
I don't know what's his eye problem. He has something wrong with his eye, I guess.
Yeah.
Okay, so since I joined
maxi pads on his head,
the F1
when he's driving.
Since I joined the F1 subreddit, I've noticed like a lot of articles are just about like so and so hates these guys because they talk shit. Like, is that all this is? Like, is it just like a big contest? It's just what the fuck?
Because of the nature of racing, man. You will find that in F1 and in any racing category, you're gonna stumble upon a lot of big egos, and that's just like
you need that.
Right? You have to be like super overconfident, like what you were saying. It's the same with fighting. Like you have to be like sure of yourself, because otherwise, like you're not. Maybe you won't go for that apex. Maybe you won't approach the corner. You know,
or even it's be on that team. Anywhere.
And be like marketable or whatever. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, the marketability is big.
Yeah.
The confidence is huge. I don't know, man. I don't think it even can be fake confidence. You can tell the guys that have the fake confidence.
Oh man, even if it's bullshit, they believe their own bullshit. Obviously they have to.
But
they have to.
They have to.
See a guy talking in his confidence mode like two or three times, you can tell. I think for most guys, you can tell if it's real or not. If they're hyping themselves up,
right?
Or if they're
demeanor,
actually sure that
right,
I am the guy. I might as well tell everybody.
Yeah,
sure.
But
at the
same time, you gotta have confidence for that, because you look like so bad if you lose.
Right,
if
totally. You're just kind of crying in the corner.
Yeah, in a race, if you don't place where you thought you'd place, in a fight, if you get knocked out or submitted.
Right. Who do you guys think has the biggest ego in Formula One, sort of right now?
I don't know, man.
It's a big competition. I'm sure.
That's all of them, right?
Yeah.
It's tough to say. The biggest ego.
Actually, right now, the field has, like, it hasn't had, like, huge, huge egos, like, sometimes in the past. I think, like, the biggest ego right now, it's got to be, like, Hamilton right now, just because he's on a big top.
Yeah. Maybe, like, I think last year, though, he was talking more big about himself, whereas now he's just, like, more matter-of-fact kind of thing.
Just like, these are the facts.
Yeah. I'm the guy. What's the problem?
The best.
Yeah, he just kind of like, just like, you know, whatever. We have, saying like,
in F1, though, over the years, we have seen some like huge arrogance.
Oh, really?
Like, one of them that was like, that really pissed me off was Juan Pablo Montoya, this Colombian guy that had a lot of potential, but like, he ruined it for himself because he was such an asshole.
Oh,
yeah. He was... I forget what race it was, but last year he was at a race and talked to Sky for a minute.
Yeah.
And he was kind of like, they were just asking me, you know, like comparing indie racing to F1.
Yeah.
And just like, he didn't even really say anything that was like, indie's better or whatever, but something in his tone was
off. What we do is better.
he knows it isn't.
He's sort of like that, but yeah, like, he's like kind of a bigger guy.
Yeah.
And he's saying that his Indy is more physical. They don't have power steering and they have like the big sticky tires. Fight a car. But he's been F1, NASCAR, and Indy driving. So I don't know. Maybe some of his confidence is warranted, I guess.
He's been there.
The three major, aside from endurance and rally, and I guess super bike racing.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the three that I don't even know. Maybe he has tried them, right?
I'm not sure. I don't know if he's ever done endurance. But yeah, maybe.
He might have got to drive a car or something. But yeah, he's raced, competed in all those three.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, not in endurance, but... Yeah. Yeah, I don't know.
Anyway, but yeah, it's big egos in F1. Obviously, like you're gonna end up with that banter, and it makes it even more like
it does, right? It adds a bit more of like intrigue. You know what I mean? Like if you hear the like drama. If I'm walking down the street and there's like two people and they're like, "Oh, nice to see you! It's so nice to see you," and they give hugs and kisses and shit, or you're walking down the street and you hear like a
brawl.
Hey, man. Fuck you. I'm like, oh, this is gonna be good.
Yeah, exactly.
So I get that. Totally get that.
Especially spectators love that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I do too.
They do. That's what I keep saying. But like F1, if you guys don't know, they started using their YouTube channel. If you check, it was registered in 2005.
And only recently they started using it. You're right.
Maybe they've been listening to us.
I think they have. Our word has gotten out to them.
This is what I've been talking about since the first show that...
FIA. Yeah. Oh no, FOM. Let us tell you how to run your business. We'll do a good. We'll tell you exactly how to do it. Don't worry.
Right. Yeah. Like, it's stuff that for whatever people do want to see that stuff. Like the what is that?
I don't know.
Somebody's knocking at the door. Yeah. They were talking about your package.
Oh God. Okay, sorry, packages came for me.
Packages are exciting.
And I'm
something
very excited.
Came in the mail.
If you want to know what it is, it's my childhood dream in a box. It's a pair of devil sticks.
Yeah, man, I was telling JB, I had those they're probably in my dad's shed if I dig through his backyard.
Oh, yeah.
I had those, man. I had a rubber set.
Oh yeah, no, that's the way I got it from a magic shop in Toronto, and I was like, I could have just gone out and drove there. It's like 20 minutes north of here. I was like, no, I'm just gonna order online, and thank God because it came today.
There you go.
I'm really excited.
There we go.
Beautiful outside.
Oh, wow,
look at this. It is a beautiful day.
This weather.
So I don't know. People who listen obviously might not live in Toronto or in Canada or live anywhere that snows, but the last. What since we started, it's been just
cold.
Super cold, just snowy, and something about Canadians and people who live in these sort of conditions is that you appreciate the shit of a beautiful day.
It's not even really these conditions, though. Like this winter was pretty intense. Like this is the worst winter in maybe almost 10 years.
Yeah, I don't know, man. Like what about last winter with the ice storm?
whatever.
That was like a day.
That was like That's a freak thing that could happen. You could have like a whatever. Yeah, that was a
cumulonimbus coming in with some agriculture. I don't know.
Shut up, Mike.
Yeah, we had one ice storm, whatever. This winter was
freezing. It was long, if anything.
Yeah, it was long. Plus, I don't know I was in Alberta last year.
It gets proper cold up there.
Oh, yeah. Well, it didn't really. I wasn't there for the proper cold, and the summer was way hotter than here. Like, we were in 35, 36, 37 degrees for about 2 weeks straight. I was up there. I was up there last summer. The summer was much, much hotter than here.
Guys.
We're about
to get our biggest feature so far.
Tatiana Calderón.
Hello. Oh.
Hello.
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 Can you see us?
Oh, hold on. I got it. All right. Suit
Skype.
There we go. Yeah.
Hi.
Hello. Hi, Tatiana.
Hello. How are you?
Good. I'm Javier.
I'm Danny.
And I'm Mike.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today.
Yes. Thank you.
No. Thank you for the invitation.
Tatiana, for those that don't know that are watching right now and don't know, is a FIA Formula 3. European Championship driver, which is one of the feeder series for Formula One, and above all that, she is Colombian, and I'm very proud of that.
Yes, sure you are.
Tatiana, thank you again. Thank you so much for joining us. We want to talk about a big thing that's been the talk recently in the Formula One circles, and it's women in F1.
I saw like that one coming.
Yeah, no introductions or nothing. I mean, we'll get to your to how you're doing right now in F3, but I want to cut right to the chase because I know that you're not a supporter of what Bernie Ecclestone is saying, that there should be a separate championship for women.
Off the top, neither am I.
Oh, that's good to know.
But what's your view on that?
Definitely. I think, of course, it's, you know, I've raised my whole life against boys, and I don't see really a need for a Formula One female championship, because I think, you know, we have, we can compete against the best, and I don't see why we need a different championship. I mean, no. To get to Formula One, it's difficult for anyone.
For anyone,
absolutely.
For females.
Yeah.
You know, there's only 20 places available, and you gotta be really good. You have to bring a lot of money, so it's difficult for everyone, and that's why I think, you know, it's not worth trying to make another championship. As well, because I don't think there's that many girls driving yet, and if I have learned something from racing in the Formula 3 in the FIA European Championship, is that you gotta compete against the best to get the best out of you and to be better. Mm-hmm. And I don't think that the level, if we get a Formula 1 championship for females, will be that high. So we wouldn't be prepared anyway.
That's a beautiful attitude to have for some, like, really challenging yourself and just being the best, right? And that's sort of what it's about.
Absolutely. And you know what? I agree completely with you. I mean, I think we all do. I think it's only like the older folk, the people that are really in power in F1 right now that don't really see it that way. But as far as I'm concerned, if you've made it to that, like to even the feeder series, like you have, as soon as you get in the cockpit and put the helmet on, everybody's the same. Then you just let your skill do the talking,
right?
And yeah. that's how it should be. And
I think Bernie's out of touch in a lot of different ways.
But, well, absolutely.
But.
Now, Tatiana, I watch a couple of your interviews before, and I one thing that I know that you've been quoted as saying a couple of times is that you want to be the first woman in F1.
yeah, it's been so long until since a girl was racing in Formula One.
Yeah, yeah, that's what I wanted to get at, because even if you do, well, and actually when you do get to F1, you'll find that there's been three women ahead of you. So you'll be the fourth woman in F1.
Exactly. But, it's just
the first one in modern times, for sure, since the 60s or whatever. The last girl that was in F1, the last woman was Lila Lombardi, and she scored a half a point in one race.
How do you get a half point?
If the race ends early. But
every point counts.
Absolutely.
Half a point is half a point. And actually, you know what? And now that I'm talking about that, I was actually reading an article on the Bleacher Report, which is an F1 blog. And they said that you are going to be the next Lila Lombardi, that you are actually going to make it to F1, and not only make it to F1, but actually score some points. And that's what, that got me really, really excited. And again, I want to congratulate you a lot, because I've looked into your career, and you've done things that, I mean, for most, to begin with, I mean, most racers, like most people get into single seater categories. Like, I don't know to what level of commitment they want to take it, but you started in karting at what, age 9?
Yeah, that's right. Research very well.
and since then, like you've just been going up and up and up through the categories, and kept going, and the last year, you finished 5th at Spa. Which is amazing.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's great.
You know, it's been a tough road, but I think, you know, I love this sport so much, and you know, I love competition, and of course you always have to have goals and targets, and of course my goal and my dream is to get to F1, and that's why I think I work hard every day. But yeah, it's not easy, and but it's you know, it's not impossible. So as long as there's a little chance, I will go for it, and of course this year is gonna be very important for me.
Yes,
because as well, you know, I'm in a very good team, which is Carlin.
Yeah, tell me about Carlin. How is working with Carlin?
Yeah, it's, you know, it's a great team. They're in every single seater championship except for F1 and and IndyCar. So they're a really big team, and
IndyCar doesn't
and
matter.
They've been very successful in every championship, really.
Yeah.
So for me, you know, it's a big year because so far I've learned a lot from them. I have really good people around me, so I'm sure I'm gonna learn a lot, and again well, I've started working with Susie Wolf this year as well.
Oh really?
She's my manager now, and that makes it you know, even more special because she knows how it feels like to be a girl in this sport, and
she knows how to get there too.
Lots of things to learn from her as well.
Oh, absolutely. And actually, I'm glad that you brought up Susie Wolf, because this is one of the things that actually made me pretty angry. Because at the start of the season, a couple races ago, when Bottas had his back problem or whatever, Susie Wolf was there, and they could have very well put her in the car.
Yeah.
And they didn't, and that's one thing that I this is what I think that is wrong, and the people on the top aren't seeing, is that they have these women drivers involved in F1 in one way or another. So Lotus now has Carmen Jordá, that we won't get into her track record because she's I don't know if she should be there, but
she supports Ecclestone's idea very openly.
Oh my God, yes.
There's been enough articles
anyway
with her wanting this women championship.
But she's just as a development driver. Everybody knows. Like, she's
It's because she knows she's not good enough herself to compete with men. I don't know, it might be easier.
But or not necessarily with men, but like at the top category.
Yeah.
So she's not gonna make it into an F1 seat. No. Susie Wolf, I thought that that she actually had a real chance, and with this Bottas thing happen, they didn't put her in the car, that was
my first thought.
Yeah, I was like, why don't you get Susie in the
Wolf's
car?
Going to be on the track.
Yeah,
no,
that would have been great, and I think that Williams missed an opportunity there, and this is what this is what we're counting on you for, to actually make a difference and get into F1. On skill, and I think that you definitely can, and I do remember one reading another article, and actually I watched Peter Windsor's channel on
YouTube
and do you know who Rob Wilson is, Tatiana?
Yeah, I've worked very closely.
Oh, you worked with Rob?
I've worked with him for the last few years. He's a great guy.
That's awesome. Yeah, he's very knowledgeable. So this guy is an old guy. He's a trainer, basically, a driver coach in a way. But he's raced in many, many different categories throughout the years. And he's coached Bottas. He's coached Raikkonen. He actually was one of the first ones who spotted Raikkonen as a young talent coming in through the series. He coached as well Juan Pablo Montoya. He did some coaching for Montoya, as far as I know. So I'm glad that you're working with him, because I'm sure that he has all kinds of connections. And one of the things that he said about you is that you're a serious racer.
Oh, that's you know, you have to give me the link because I have
I'll send you a link.
I have worked with him the last couple of years, and I think he's a great coach, and of course, you know, like having people like Kim or Susie, you know, supporting me and giving me all the advice is what I need right now.
Yeah, for sure.
To get those results and show that I can be the next...
The next you.
The next Susie Wolf.
Well, hopefully you can do better than she did.
Girl.
Yeah, so far.
To jump into a Formula One. Because, you know, if I get there, yeah. It's not...
When you get there.
I don't want to just, you know... sit there and say that I'm a development driver or whatever. I really want to have a chance. Otherwise,
no. We want you in a car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
For sure.
Exactly. Yeah. I want to be driving in that car. That's
You want to compete.
That's my dream and hopefully I can, you know, do well this year to deserve that chance.
Because this year is, I'm sorry, I mean, I'm going to put it bluntly, but this year is basically going to be, it's a bit of a do or die year for you in a way, because it's going to be your third year now in European Formula 3. And at this point, like you so let me just go back to just to recap here your career in Formula 3 right now. I took some notes. so you joined the series. When was it here? I got it here somewhere. 2011, right? Oh no, actually, you.
Yeah, 2013.
Oh, 2013. Sorry. Yes. Yeah. So you joined there, and you were racing for Double R Racing.
Yeah, that's right.
And you had the best, your best finish for the year was a 17th at the third race in over there in Austria. At the end of the year, you ranked 32nd in the championship with 0 points. So you went from, you know, with a team that I don't know the reputation of Double R, but so you ended up that year with 0 points, then came back 2014, and as far as I know, it was like a last minute thing that you switched to another team when was it, Joe Zeller Racing, is that right? Like, so it had to be done like very last minute.
Yeah, that's right.
Something about like they didn't even have the seat ready for you or something.
It was, you know, I finished my seat fit at 4 a.m. in the morning, and we had practice at 9.
Oh, my God.
I was supposed to race with a new team, Signature.
Okay.
A French team, and they had a Renault engine, and Renault was just coming back to F3, and the engine was not performing well enough, so we decided
not surprised actually.
yeah, Ren is having trouble.
Yeah, no doubt.
A little bit.
So you came back.
To switch.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah, I had to switch. You know, the day before the only place available, which was for Joe Seller. It was a tough start of the season for me.
But that's, you know, these kind of tough decisions are the decisions that eventually you're going to need to make tough decisions when you're advancing through your single seater career. But anyway, let me recap here for these guys, because they didn't do their research as well as I did. So 2014, last year, you started with Joe Zeller last minute. But you got that best finish of fifth at Spa, which is, we've been talking about it like since we started the podcast. Spa is like one of our all time favorite tracks.
And what are there, like 35 competitors in the series?
Yeah, 35. How many guys are there?
This year
36. Yeah, so there's a ton of guys, and you got fifth. Yeah, a ton of racers, and you got fifth at Spa. After a bit of a bumpy start, because I'm sure like getting used to the new team, getting used to how they work, must have been a bit of a you had to learn quick and then get used to everything, right?
Yeah, it was very, very tough, and I think that's, you know, we had no practice, because in this championship. testing is very restricted as well.
Okay.
So I was testing basically on the race weekends. Had no engineer in the first few races.
Oh my gosh.
So it was a tough one.
Wow, that's crazy. Yeah. But then towards the end of the year, let me just do another recap here. So you finish in the point more than just that fifth spot. You finished 10th in the Norris Ring, then an eighth in Moscow, then ninth in Austria again, ninth in the Nürburgring, actually nine and an eighth the next day at the Nürburgring again, then ninth at Imola and eighth at Hockenheim. So once you got all these little bugs sorted out, you were in the points consistently, pretty much, which is great to see. And that is an attribute that I think that separates, like, you know, somebody that's trying and somebody that actually has a lot of potential, is being able to demonstrate reliability and being
consistent,
being a consistent driver.
Yeah, that's incredible. Congratulations.
Yeah, congratulations. Actually, I have a question for you on that. In one of the interviews that I watch of you, you said that you look forward to every single race. And I mean, of course, I mean, why wouldn't you?
You're
racing a single seater car. But I looked at the layout of the Norris Ring, and come on, is that seriously a racetrack? What do you actually think about the Norris Ring?
Well, it's very different to a track like Spa, definitely.
I'm pulling it out on a picture here so Danny can see it.
Yeah, what?
Like,
what the hell is that on the side of a highway or something?
It's,
is that some? That's train tracks beside it, I guess.
Yeah,
is it like in a rail yard?
Earth.
How short is it? How long? There's no scale on this.
It's 2 kilometers.
2 kilometers.
it's all about braking, really, and it's very bumpy over there, but
it's like a rectangle.
You know, of course, it's not my favorite place to go, but the atmosphere and the amount of people that go and watch that race is actually very, very high, so...
Because most of the year...
That's why DTM keeps going there. And still, you know, with the straights, you get to see some racing as well. But yeah, definitely, I'm looking forward to Spa and Po, which is another street circuit, but very, very nice.
Po is in France, right?
Sorry?
Paul in France, right?
Exactly.
Yeah, Paul, actually, for you guys that don't know, Paul is the place where Grand Prix racing started, period. That was the Paul Grand Prix was the very first Grand Prix in the world. Oh. Yeah, there you go. That's a tip.
So you've been now 3 years on three new teams? Three separate teams?
Yeah. Well, let me get to 2015. I haven't gotten to 2015 yet.
So I'm just going to say, like, I said earlier, I started, well, before this interview started, yeah. I started a new job on Monday and, you know, like meeting like a dozen new people and like figuring out how does this work? It's a bit weird, but for a racing team and then,
oh my God,
you get there at 4 a.m. and start driving 5 hours later. That's insane.
It's a dedication, and your training regimen is very intense from what I read. Like you don't just train for the races. Like you train all the time. You're like pretty much training every day, right? Something like 15 hours of every week. That's what I read.
I enjoy training as well, but you know, to be honest, If I don't train that much, I wouldn't be able to drive the car to the limit, because the F3 is very tough physically, because we don't have power steering like Formula One.
Oh wow! Crazy.
So it's the steering is really, really heavy, and again we, you know, I think the Formula 3 has a lot of downforce.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's
how many G's do you get around a corner? Like
top.
Yeah,
that was actually one of the questions I wanted to ask. I've driven a Honda Civic before with no power steering, and I'm sure that's nothing compared to, like, the tires on it are, they're like 13 inch, you know, they're like four or five inches wide. they're not sticky. What's that?
Yeah, that would be nothing. Yeah, so
yeah, exactly.
You must get some pretty crazy cornering G's, I'm sure.
What do these cars weigh? They have three cars.
It weighs 700 kilos.
Okay. Close to Honda Civic, but it's, I'm sure it's harder to steer for.
So it's I don't know, for example, Silverstone, mm-hmm. turn one, which is flat out.
Yeah, that corner is intense.
Speed is 200.
Oh my god,
20. Yeah. So the steering is quite heavy at that speed,
and the G forces too.
And and the G and your neck. And
oh my god,
of course, I think you know, Formula One is more about the neck. And endurance.
Yeah, that's what you hear all the time.
And F3, we have shorter races, but we don't have power steering, and we still carry a lot of speed through the corners, so the neck still suffers, not as much as F1, but a fair amount. So yeah, that's why I train really hard, because if there's a difference between girls and boys in this sport, it may be the physical aspect, but right. There's nothing that we can't fix, you know. I just train a little bit more than the guys,
yeah,
and I can cope with it.
Oh, that's a fantastic attitude. Yeah. Now, another thing actually that's interesting that I read about F3 is that, okay, so you get very little, if anything at all, in terms of telemetry. So there's hardly any telemetry, and that's to kind of force the drivers to be in tune with the car and actually like learn that aspect as well. Is that am I right in saying that? Like you actually have to like know about the mechanics of the car a bit to be able to give the feedback back to the engineers?
Yeah, I think definitely Formula 3 is more similar to F1, because in the regulations you can touch a lot of parts from the car, modify them.
Okay.
Which in other championships it's not allowed.
Okay.
So of course the feedback of the driver is very important for the teams to develop the car, and that's why I think Formula 3 is a great series to do before, or prepares you to go to any other series, because you have to work really really hard with your engineer to get them out the most out of the car as well.
Yeah.
And for sure, I'm learning a lot of the technical side, which in other championships you don't really get to experience.
So for an example, say you think the camber should be adjusted, the suspension should be harder, softer. Would you tell the engineers how much you think these adjustments should be, or would you say like a little harder, a little softer, and they would try to just figure it out for you, or like, well, or what are the, how much input do the drivers have?
It's not like I tell my engineer, hey, I think I need more camber for this and that corner. I really say, okay, I've got understeer in this and this corner, and maybe if I remember from a different day that we tested, you know, they tell you what they do when you go out and test, and they tell you, okay, we just we put softer springs on the back so you should feel like you have more traction, and mm-hmm. and let's see what that affects on other corners, or if that makes it worse. So you have an idea sometimes, and you can tell your engineer if you have little time, like in qualifying, you know, if you stop for a quick change and you say, I think we should go softer with the springs, because you got that feeling from before. For sure, that's gonna make his life a lot easier. But we tend to only say, okay, I've got understeer, and the engineer's job is to decide which of the areas, because you can touch a lot of different things to solve the problem. Hmm. It's his job to make that decision.
Hmm. Cool. Okay. All right. So and now, okay. So we were stuck in last year. Now this year, you went to Carlin, or you are at Carlin right now. And from another interview that I watch of yours, you were basically saying that, you know what, if I don't get the right team to continue in F3, I might look into other options. And somebody was saying that maybe even GP3. Am I right in understanding that F3 is maybe a little bit higher in terms of category than GP3? Like, what would be the difference?
Well, I think there is more level in the last couple of years in F3, because you know, the last 2 years, two drivers have jumped straight from Formula 3 to Formula 1. And right now, like, there's 35 cars. Formula 3 is a bit more open championship. Mm-hmm. In terms of regulation, so that the drivers can, you know, develop more and okay. get more track time as well. Because in GP3, you only get one practice of 45 minutes. And then two races. In F3, you get two practice sessions, two qualifying, three races. So three it's a races. Lot more.
Yeah.
Wow. A lot more that you can learn.
Okay.
And I think, you know, the Formula One teams, they're all watching Formula 3, because a lot of today's champions and current Formula One drivers have passed through there.
Max Verstappen being one of them. Didn't he? Okay, so he won last year or something, and then he went right, or the year before, and he went to F1 now, and he's doing a mighty job. But I have it from, because I've seen it on YouTube, that you made a fantastic pass on him. It's on your channel somewhere, but I saw it on YouTube and I was like, this is awesome. So you could easily overtake him then when you two were racing together, and now he's overtaking people in F1. So that makes me think that this is why I'm sure that you should be there. You should be in F1. You're probably better than Pastor Maldonado, I tell you that.
Probably. Come on. I'm probably better than Pastor Maldonado.
I've seen you've really done great research, and you know, I really enjoyed that weekend, and especially you know, that race, because of course everyone knew that Verstappen was gonna race in Formula One the year after. So it also means a lot to you, because it meant a lot to me, because you know, I'm competing with F1 driver, so that means I'm not far away.
Oh, I don't think that's you are. Right. And this goes back to what I said before. So this has to be the year that you either, and sorry to put it this way, but you either start getting on the podiums, and then get noticed that way, or not, and people are gonna start wondering why. So there's, I can't even imagine the huge amount of pressure that you must be in, internally and whatever, to be able to perform in that way. But this year you're in a team that, like you said, is renowned. I mean, Carlin. For you guys, Sebastian Vettel came from Carlin. Nico Rosberg raced for Carlin. Bruno Senna, like, they have a whole roster of guys. Kevin Magnussen, Daniel Kvyat. These guys have all raced for Carlin in one or other of the categories. And Ricardo, another Carlin alumnus. So these guys are now in F1 or have been in F1. So this is a team that actually has a good pedigree. And this is a team that can make a difference. I'm sure from what you from the way that you're standing, and actually give you the machinery and the expertise that you might need to be able to achieve some podiums this year. Am I right?
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, you're right. This year is very important for me, mm-hmm. and it's time to show what I can do. And you know, I'm very lucky to have, you know, to be able to be with Carlin, which is a great team. I'm sure I'm gonna have a very competitive car throughout the whole year. As I said, I have Susie helping me as well, so I need to take this opportunity with both hands and grab it. And yeah. Hopefully, you know, you never know what's gonna happen, but yeah, definitely my goal is to get on that podium, mm-hmm. and you know, be consistent in the top 10 again.
Great, that's awesome. Tatiana, are you in the UK right now? Is that where you're calling us from?
In where, sorry?
In England.
Yes, I moved a week ago, actually.
Oh yeah, you were in Madrid before, right?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. So now you're in the UK, obviously, to be closer to the team and whatnot. It's nearing on 10 o'clock over there, I guess, right now. When I talked to your press person over email, I said that this was only going to last for 15 minutes. Well, we've gone way over that. But I mean, like, I don't know. What do you like? Do you want to hang out a little bit more? I got a couple more questions, if you're okay with that.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, go ahead. I'm having a really good time.
great. We are too.
Yeah, thanks for calling, by the way. Again. Taking time out of your Friday evening.
While I was, you know, doing my research and whatnot, I stumbled upon something really interesting. Earlier this year, in February, you went to this thing in Cancun, the Drivers Challenge. How was that?
I really had a lot of fun, you know. I was invited to do this they're organizing this new championship with mm-hmm. a lot of different drivers from Latin America, mm-hmm. and you know, it was quite a
the best junior drivers, some may say.
yeah some of the best ones, and it was so we were competing in go-karts and then in kart cross.
Mm-hmm, okay. It's like go-karts in the mud.
Sorry?
It's a kart cross. It's like go-karts, but in the dirt, right?
Yeah, exactly. But this time it was on the same track.
Oh, okay.
Actually, that the go-karts. So it was, you know, the first go-kart. I won the first race.
Excuse me. You schooled them. I saw the end of that race, and I was like, "What? You were way ahead until like the very last lap or something. Some kid there was trying to sneak up on you, but no way."
That sounds like a lot of fun, actually.
It was a close one, but it was, you know, a great start of the year, and you know, it's always great to get back behind to drive a go-kart, because that's where I started, and you know, that feeling is still there, that, you know, it doesn't disappear, and I was really happy to win, because it you know,
I'm sure it's great. And
SD card.
some F1 racers even say that karting is the purest form of motorsport. Oh, wait, something happened.
Uh-oh. We lost the internet connection.
Wait, it's trying. It's trying to do it again. We lost Tatiana Calderón. Hello?
Hello?
Oh, okay, you're back. We're back. Yeah, sorry about that.
Or is that Vodafone?
It was probably our internet connection over here in the great white north.
It's Vodafone.
Anyway, no, what I was going to say is that, you know, some F1 drivers and commentators all say that, you know, karting is the purest form of motorsport because everybody's in these tiny little machines and you're just racing for the sake of racing.
I used to go, when I was a little kid, my grandma took me a whole bunch to the Centennial Park go-kart track. It's pretty close to here. It's like a big, big track, but it's a lot of fun.
I know.
I haven't been there enough. Actually, I went 3 years ago. It was the last time. It was a lot of fun, though.
Yeah. But that's, I love
it. Yeah, karting is just so much fun, to be honest.
Yeah. I would love to do that now. Like, I wish I had time.
We'll go, the three of us.
We'll go. No,
I want my own go-kart.
I wasn't saying together.
No, like not sit in the same car. Like, I want to own one.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
let's buy go-karts.
Sure. Tatiana, going back to you. I want to just finish off like this year in F3 before I move on to another couple questions that I got. I watched, because the FIA was wonderful enough to put the first three races of the year up online on YouTube. They're there. They have a channel. Anybody can watch them. So I watched the first three races of this year at Silverstone. So do you start at the same, like on the same pit straight that the F1 cars do? Because I know that there's two pit straights in the old one and the new one.
Use the old one still.
Yeah, we do. We start on the same.
The new one.
In the new one, yes.
All right.
Because see, and this is something that I saw. I was like, wow. So there's 30 something odd racers there, and man,
throws back all the way around the corner.
That would be beautiful to see in F1, man. From the moment that I saw that, I was like, this is awesome, but also like
terrifying.
Terrifying, and pretty much every single one of those first races, or at least the first one, there was an accident at the first corner. Something like that.
The back guys are going 200 already. The guys that start at the back.
Yeah, but
got a lot of 16-year-olds joining the championship these days after Max Verstappen.
Yeah, I guess so.
So, and know, it's a bit crazy on the first lap.
I bet, and actually, from what I read, I mean, so you. The races are not too long. They're, I guess, 100 kilometers or 35 minutes, whatever happens first.
Russia.
Something like that, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, so that amounted to 18 laps.
Yeah, Silverstone's a long track.
Yeah, so
big track.
I mean, there's not much that you can do in 18 laps from what I saw. And even in the first race, I saw you climbing up. But there's just not enough time. F3, just from that, I mean, you got to qualify pretty high to be able to score on the podium. There's a lot of pressure on your qualifying sessions, right?
Yeah, definitely. You know, you have only 20 minutes. You have one set of new tires, and you have 35 guys trying to find their right spot.
Right. All right.
On track to. You know, it's very tough because you have maybe two clear laps, and that's all you've got, because then you've got traffic.
You need space in front of you.
You know, the peak of the tire, which gives you like 4/10, is gone. So it's very, very tough. And for sure, as you said, you know, you have to qualify well because the races are just too short and it's very difficult to overtake as well, because we're all in that same pace. You know, there's maybe 25 cars in 1 second.
Right.
So it's a very tough to overtake. And for sure, that's something I really need to work on my qualifying and on finding that gap and that lap. And it's for sure going to be the key to perform well.
Mine in that you're relying on Carling for some of that, at least. Sorry.
Yeah, you mentioned the tire, like you get one set of fresh tires. People might want to know, do you start the race then on the qualifying tires like F1, do you?
Yeah, we do.
The same set? Oh, you do? Okay.
We do. we have we have two qualifying sessions,
right?
And we have three sets of tires, and you always put one set in each qualifying, and then you have one set that you can use in the races you want.
So you
because
three.
You have three races, so it's up to you to choose whether you use half a set for one race, half a set for the other one, and then struggle and
brand new.
In
brand.
One of the races.
So you get three sets for the whole weekend then?
Exactly.
And all the same?
Yeah, all the same.
And are they all the same for the whole season, or do they change compound depending on the track?
No, we have the same compound
one
for
set,
every race.
Yeah.
Cool. Well, but Silverstone, let's put it that way, it was a rough weekend for you. You didn't do, I mean, maybe not what you were expecting.
Yeah, definitely a very tough weekend. I think, you know, Silverstone has always been a tricky track for me.
Yeah, for everybody, I think.
And times were very, very close. You know, 3/10 could have put me P12 in qualifying, and I didn't get that lap done.
Okay.
And then everything just gets more difficult when you start at the back. But I think I've learned lots of things during that weekend where I really need to work on to make sure I get qualifying.
Okay.
So I'm pretty confident the next race, which is at Hockenheim.
In 2 weeks, right?
Two
yeah.
Weeks.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've done well there, and I know what I need to do and what I need to focus on.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, I'm going to go flat out.
Perfect.
You get the flat out fever?
Yeah. Yes.
We're going to be rooting for you.
Yeah, oh, we are. We're definitely going to be for one, I can tell you right now, I'm going to be watching
the
races.
Let's do a thing.
Okay, yeah, we'll do a thing. We'll do a thing. we will do a thing. Okay, so that is the action in F3 so far. But what I also wanted to go through is that I find that the way that you even got into all this from the beginning is very, very interesting, because your sister played a big part, right? She basically took you and was like, hey, go-karts are really fun. Why don't you come with me?
Yeah, exactly. You know, she's 7 years older than me, but we've always done things together, and she just took me to these rental the rental cars, and I loved it, and so we were there competing. You know, they did a few championships on the nights and on the weekends, and we started winning that, and then my dad brought us a go-kart, and that's how it all started. But you know, it's always been something we did in family, like
and that must have been very, very important, the family support to you.
Yeah, definitely. You know, they've always been there for me. You know, when I graduated school,
mm-hmm.
well, I had to choose, you know, of course, my choice was always racing.
Yes.
We're not that keen on letting me do that, but you know, with results, I show them that I deserve a chance, and that's why I'm 100% focused on racing. Thanks to them.
Oh, we're very thankful to Mr. and Mrs. Calderón that they let you do this. and that's actually really cool, because one of the things that we actually were talking on the podcast on an episode that when the whole, you know, female drivers and stuff like that started being talked about in F1 like a month and a half ago. Yeah. One thing that I do remember saying is that, you know, the problem is that there just isn't that many female drivers. Period in the lower categories, and it's gotta be because in one in like a very, very like instinctual level, like it has to require a step from you as a dad to be able to say to your little girl, okay, you can jump in this motor vehicle, and it probably has to do with like the same reason why I at 15 didn't really have a curfew, but my sister, 3 years older than me, she still had a curfew. You know what I mean? It's like, that's and the family tends to be very, very protective of the girls. Obviously, that's a thing, and for somebody to overcome that and to actually encourage you. To race and to, I mean, motor racing is a dangerous sport.
Yeah, pulling 2 or 3 G's, 220 at Silverstone.
Yeah, it's fantastic that they're behind you, and I mean, I'm sure that it's very difficult for them because you're not living in Colombia. You haven't been for a while, right?
Yeah, no, my third year away.
Oh. Yeah,
your family is all still in Colombia.
Yeah, my parents are, and my sister is back in Madrid.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. She's so starting, finishing now.
Okay.
But yeah, it's tough because it's a long way away from home. Yeah. But it's worth the risk.
absolutely.
So.
But of course, you know, I agree with you. It's of course you ask a dad if he would live, you know, instead of a boy, a girl, and they would think more than, you know, like,
yeah, like if
it's difficult for girls too.
Yeah, absolutely, but you know, it's fantastic, and like I'm sure, like you said, like with the results that you had, you proved them that you were on the right track. And going back to you and your sister racing, I read that you guys together, you won the Colombian endurance race or the championship or something.
Yes, we did.
Endurance racing is honestly something that has fascinated me for a while, because it's got to be very mentally and physically taxing. How long were the races? Like 6 hours, 12 hours?
Yes, 6 hours was the longest one.
Okay.
And okay. It was two hour stints.
Oh my God.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's very tough, but very and very challenging, because you know there's a lot of different categories.
Mm-hmm.
And cars going quicker than you being quicker than other categories, so it's a lot of fun, and you know, it was very special because we did it as a team.
Yeah.
And as a family, and two girls. So it was very special.
Oh yeah, that's
beautiful.
And you love that. From what I gather in your interviews, you love being the one girl in a field of guys and showing them how it's done.
Definitely, you know, it's great when you beat them and you see the faces, and I love that.
Yeah, I bet.
And that's why, you know, there shouldn't be a Formula One female series. There would be no fun.
Absolutely. Another thing that I found hilarious too, I mean, is that you said that at one point when the whole motor racing career was becoming more and more of a reality as a path in life that you were going to choose, your dad basically told you you're not going to go to NASCAR. if anything, you're going to race single seaters.
Yeah, well, he I'm not a big fan of ovals either. But you know, it was because I raced in Star Mazda in the United States, and I did a few ovals, and I didn't really like them that much.
They're boring.
And it was by the time that Dan Weldon got killed in Las Vegas that, okay, my dad and I, we decided, okay, let's go to Europe, because my dream has always been Formula One, and let's try it.
good choice.
Yeah.
And I'm so happy that we made that decision.
I bet.
We are too. To be honest.
Another thing I wanted to ask you about F3 is another F3 driver we've been following a bit is Lance Stroll.
Oh, yeah.
I was wondering, I don't know, have you met him? Like, what do you think about him? Us being Canadians. I think he's the one Canadian in there.
I raced against Lance last year in the Florida Winter Series as well.
Oh, yeah.
Which you won one race.
Yeah, I won one of the races. And, you know, I think he's a very good driver. He won the Formula 4 Championship. And I think he will do very well this year. He's in a very good team. As well in Prema Power Team, he's got very good teammates as well. So I'm sure he's gonna learn a lot, and he's still very young. So
yeah,
you know, it's I'm sure he's gonna do well.
I think we've seen a lot though in all forms of racing that age isn't all that important. In racing,
you gotta, or gender. I mean, you gotta let your skill do the talking. Really, I mean, it is what it comes down to. Mike, I've seen you for a while wanting to ask a question there.
Oh, I don't know. A lot of questions I have are just about competition and sort of what I've sort of gathered from this interview so far is that how much you enjoy, like skill and competition and like sort of honoring that, and because of your gender, not that it makes any difference, but like you absolutely let your skill do the talking, and I found that to be a breath of fresh air in terms of like, so I'm very recent to Formula One, and I noticed there's a lot of talking. People talk a lot.
Yeah, I was gonna say, there's not as much One. Well, like Nico Rosberg.
Yeah,
he's letting his talking do the talking. Not the right way to go.
I think that's a breath of fresh air in terms. It's not really a question, but I think that's fantastic in terms of the sport and the direction it's going.
Yeah, just sportsmanship in general.
Totally.
Yeah, it's great. I mean, you're very humble, Tatiana, and we're glad about that, because a lot of people that get into single seaters, when we're discussing this, there's a lot of big egos in this sport for sure.
Egos, yeah. We were talking about that just before you called.
I mean,
you don't have to say anything about that.
Clearly, your ego is in check.
Yeah. Anything. Anyway, I mean, so it's past 10 o'clock in London now. I'm sure you got better things to do than talk to the three of us. But Tatiana, can we ask you for a follow up chat later in the year?
Definitely.
Yes.
Definitely. Oh, that's fantastic.
Absolutely.
Cool. Yeah, because we want to check on your progress and see how everything is going, and you know, the road to F1.
Sure. thank you very much for. I had a great time.
That's awesome. Great. We had a great time too.
Yeah, us too.
Yeah.
Anytime.
Cool.
We keep in touch and hopefully with good news.
of course.
Or bad ones, whatever. Who cares?
Yeah. Either way.
Yeah. Listen.
We'll be here.
Obviously, congrats on your success so far.
Yeah.
Good luck going forward,
and
I'm sure you got it.
We'll send you the to your press officer. We'll send it once the episode comes out. We'll send in the link and all that. Other than that, I mean, you know, be safe, keep all four wheels on the track, and keep showing the guys how it's done.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
We speak soon then.
Yeah. All righty.
Take care.
Bye.
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 Bye. Bye. Oh, that was great.
That was awesome. That was so fantastic. Yeah, that was cool. Oh, you took your headphones off.
What's your headphones off for? Oh,
shit. We're still on. you goof.
it's not over.
I'll be right back.
Yeah, no. I do have to urinate.
Okay, the lineup. The lineup is starting.
That was fantastic. How cool is she?
Yeah, she's great. I'm even more stoked for her to get up there now.
Oh, no, no. Now we're rooting for her. This is it. We're going to have our own pool.
Yeah, this is what I was saying like last week that, again, going back to fighting. Yeah. But anyways, I'm not going to apologize anymore for making the comparisons because they're very similar. I think the mindset of the competitors is very similar.
Right.
Obviously, these guys aren't, or and girls, aren't punching each other in the head.
Yeah.
Like the guys and girls in right. F1, in UFC are.
Yeah, but you wouldn't want like a girl fighting a guy in UFC.
Yeah. So Ecclestone is proposing a separate, or he proposed anyways, a separate league or whatever, like a follow-on series to F1 for women. And in the UFC, Dana White is kind of like the... Not quite, but he's kind of like the Bernie Eccleston of UFC. And he said a few years ago that women would never compete in the UFC. Obviously, it's a little... Like, racing is one of the few sports, I think, where women can compete with men, like, fairly on an equal playing field. Like, right. They're not smashing into each other.
Trying to
steal a ball, trying to kick whatever, like, kick a ball past each other. And he said it would never happen.
Right.
Now there's two classes... Obviously, a woman will never fight a man
right.
on television, at least, for money, for a prize. But like racing needs like a Ronda Rousey-type character. That's what women's fighting needed,
right.
was someone that has the right attitude, the skill, the presence, the
everything.
The way of talking.
Package.
Yeah, it seems
all right, now
Tatiana's on her way. I don't know if she knows who Ronda Rousey is, hopefully. She doesn't mind the comparison. Ronda Rousey's a badass chick. But yeah, it seems... I'm so against the women separate league, though.
As soon as I heard about it, I thought it was a joke.
It's like an 80-year-old man's idea.
Yeah, exactly.
What you would expect from an 80-year-old man.
Jesus. I honestly thought it was one of those like one of those things that came from F1 Circle Jerk. That's honestly, I thought like, it's Formula 1... For girls, like a WNBA. No. It wouldn't work. And there's no way that it would work, period.
Yeah. And
or that it's necessary.
People don't, like, no disrespect to any female basketball players, but people don't watch the WNBA. But people would watch if a woman competed in the NBA.
Oh, yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, I don't know. It's hard to say with a lot of sports. Which ones women could physically compete with, but racing is clearly one of those.
Oh, yeah.
Where it's right down to your mental focus and your skill of pointing the car in the right direction and controlling it.
And just like you were saying, hey.
Keeping the four wheels on the track, as you say.
Yeah. And like you were saying, man, like if you have the right attitude, the right physique, and the right number of skills, then... It can be done for many sports. Like I know that this chick that I do remember that from the Winter Olympics that just passed. There's a Swiss, the Swiss goalie is supposed to be like the best female goalie in the world, or one of the best for hockey.
Right.
If you read about it, like.
They wanted her on the men's team?
Well, no, like what she does, like off of the Olympics is that, like, I think she plays for like a male only team. Oh. Or like, and then she's like the goalie for like a guy's team.
In Switzerland.
No. And she actually like at that point was in Canada.
Jesus. Thank you very much.
Well, check it out. Check out the beer.
Tsingtao.
This is because China was last week.
I did it. I figured it out.
Dude.
You know what? I need your opener too. I took mine off my keychain.
This is rubbish.
It is rubbish. It kind of worked. I took it off for the orientation shit I had to do for my new job this week. But it was, I don't know, kind of a good
orientation. Am I right?
Yeah, you are correct. It was exactly what I said. It was just banking info and my address, and they gave me a binder like 300 pages long to read about their company policies. I just kind of just flip through it. And
when I went to China, this was everywhere.
Beer?
Yeah. The beer.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Cheers.
And cheers to you guys at home. Thank you again for watching. This is I think when we started this, we didn't realize how deep we would go.
Yeah.
And I feel like...
we're in there.
Yeah, we're... It's going to be a consistent thing.
Yeah.
this is not bad, actually.
Despite our inconsistencies recently... And again, I'm sorry about that, guys. The episode didn't come earlier in the week, and we're probably going to have to cut down our analysis of China a bit short, and as well as our preview, because we're basically in the weekend right now of the Bahrain Grand Prix.
Oh yeah, yeah, already.
FP1 and FP2 were this morning.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's done. Yeah.
So regular service will resume soon.
Yeah. I apologize as well. I started a new job this week and got some other stuff going on.
But thanks for hanging on.
Yeah. Normally I make notes and do research. Have questions prepared.
Bring your laptop at least.
Yeah, my laptop. I had this new job though. I didn't know. I haven't found a spot where I could like hide it, and I don't know all the guys yet. And I was telling you before, like, we don't need to talk about them before.
Can I open this?
Sure. Yeah,
you can open whatever you like.
Cool. All right.
Yeah, I should have had my laptop. I got my phone here, but I had last night. I was doing. Next week I'll be prepared. I was doing a little like. Expose on women in racing. Mm-hmm. I started on it. I got all the links open on my laptop, and this morning I was like, I was about to bring it, and then I decided against it because I wasn't sure.
No worries, man. No worries.
Well, yeah, whatever. Get the rest up here.
It keeps going up. The amount of people that are listening to us on iTunes and other podcast methods available. So yeah,
thanks for everyone who clicked the subscribe button.
Welcome to all the new
click
people.
Click it now.
Yeah. Click subscribe. Give us a like or two if you like this interview with a fantastic, absolutely wonderful, easy to talk to.
Down to earth.
Down to earth.
Holy moly.
And never mind, like, she just look her up on Google. She's kind of cute, too.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah. Beautiful. Oh my God. Tatiana Calderón.
It's going to be great when she gets to F1 because, I guess, right? Well, he is a great driver. You got Alonso, the Spanish guy.
Yeah.
But if you can narrow it, like, Spanish, kind of like, you know, Latin American. It's like
Hispanic.
It's Hispanic. Yeah. But a Colombian. Oh my God. You know, I got a German and a Brit to cheer for. They're both world champions. Well, not that Alonso isn't, but they're both world champions. You know.
Well, if
Alonso's got the skill up there, but
if Tatiana, like if
you got
Tatiana
a Colombian
makes it
in there.
Yeah. If Tatiana makes it like to F1 on skill alone and like starts racking up the points, I think it's gonna be like not good, just not just
is it glow in the dark?
I don't know.
You gotta get that thing under a black light.
I don't know, but I'm real excited about this. It's one of those therapy,
you have to,
therapy things.
You bring that to way home.
Oh my God, I'm definitely gonna bring that.
Yeah. Did you buy your tickets yet? You dick.
No,
anyway,
Way Home Festival. Even you Americans who live in the northeastern states,
yeah,
get up to Way Home. Check it out, wayhome.com.
Yeah, wayhome.com. It's going to be this summer. Just
I found Incubus is playing the week after.
Oh,
but I'm going to be going. It's Edgefest.
Oh, wow. Edgefest still going on? It's still a thing,
I know, right? Usually Incubus plays like their own show at the Molson Amphitheater.
Okay.
And it's like just them, or like there's like some.
Right, yeah, Incubus.
And now it's like
bands.
They're playing part of a festival.
I went 2 years or 3 years ago. I think the headliner was Billy Talent. Kind of sucks.
Wow.
And maybe Death From Above co headlined. But
that would have been all right.
It would have been all right. The bassist dude is a dick, man. He stopped playing twice during the show to smoke cigarettes. And the drummer, like I was hanging onto the fence at the stage, and the drummer was like, dude, like telling him to like get up. And he was literally crouched down behind his keyboard, just like this, like basically on his knees, just smoking a cigarette casually like that. He was clearly drunk as fuck too.
Yeah.
I'm not sure if I'll be going to Edgefest, but Incubus is tempting though.
Yeah,
I've never seen them live.
Mother as well is playing.
I'm a huge Mother Mother is playing at Way Home.
No, it hasn't been announced,
but
is it if it's 100% that they're playing, I'm fucking there.
It's one of those
hinted tweets that they sent out.
Yeah, yeah.
All right, let's wrap this bitch up.
Everybody, come to Way Home. Wrap what bitch up?
What
you want to go? Devil's Texas?
A little bit. I just got them.
Put those things back in the box.
Yeah, we still haven't even talked about the China or Bahrain.
Oh, okay. I'm sorry.
We are going to talk about it. We're just not going to spend that much time.
Felt the wine down. I don't know what I... No? No. Just me?
I had two sips of this beer. I'm not even past the Tsing Tao embossed.
Okay. My apologies.
So what happened last week? Danny, can you illuminate this for us?
Yeah. Nico Rosberg confirmed that he's kind of a dick.
A pussy.
And a pussy. Yeah.
Maybe that's why he puts
that all about?
Maybe that's why he puts a maxi pad on his helmet.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
He's a pussy.
He didn't even know what the thing was called last week. He said you haven't seen the race, Mike, but if you haven't seen the race, anyone listening, it's worth just seeing the post-race interviews or the mini press conference after the race. He said that Lewis was holding him up, and then that compromised his tires, which compromised his race, and that Lewis was being selfish, which I don't think he was.
Okay, but listen,
they got a 1-2. Like, if he was gonna fight Lewis and get in front,
he should have done it.
He should have got up there and then fought Lewis and got in front. The team is clear; they're the most open about not having team orders. Unless they do now, because they won a double championship, maybe. But I think to the team, a double championship, whether it's the same driver or both drivers,
it doesn't matter.
Is equal, and it would probably be better for the team if Nico won. That proves that it's not just Hamilton; it's their car is badass.
Yeah,
but I think it's more Hamilton.
Oh, for sure.
I don't know, man. Like, Rosberg outclassed him a few times last year, especially in qualifying.
Right,
but. He tried playing, I think, I don't know, man. There's so many things. Like, he tried the mental game too hard, maybe, and lost his own edge. Or he pushed the mental game and strengthened Lewis so much.
Yeah.
I don't know.
He put
Either
himself,
way, he's not pulling it off anymore.
He put himself in a position last year. He put himself in a position where it was, where it is now. Damned if he does, damned if he doesn't. Last year, we had a Nico Rosberg that was trying anything, and he got to Hamilton a couple times. He got in because at one point Nico was ahead in the championship, remember, for very briefly.
Yeah, he was.
But in
the last race there was a chance for Nico to win the championship.
Yeah, exactly,
with the double points.
That's true. Yeah,
there was a chance for him.
Yeah,
right down to the last race,
right down. But he got into Lewis's head. But he also tried things like, you know, what one could argue was cheating in Monaco. He tried just, you know, calling Lewis out. He actually out-qualified Lewis a few times, way more than a handful. So he did that, and he still didn't win. So now this year's and he got criticized a lot last year for many things, and many things that he said or didn't say, or the way that he said some things. So now we're coming back to F1. He hasn't outclassed Hamilton at all. He clearly is agitated by some comments that Hamilton has made, and also just like he seems almost at a loss, and he's running out of things to try.
Yeah,
obviously
the team's not even backing him, saying like, yeah, we agree, maybe Lewis was a bit selfish or whatever. They're not doing any of that. And yesterday or the day before, Button, somebody, I don't know if he was asked or if he just said it, but Button told him to like chill out, like with his comments.
Yo, chill, bro.
Yeah, he Button was in some sort of interview and told him like, just do your talking on track. Because Button raced, he was on teammates with Lewis for 3 years, I think.
So at McLaren,
at least three, 3 years at McLaren. So he knows him probably better than most of the other drivers. Mm-hmm. Well, I don't know.
Maybe.
On the other hand, Rosberg and Lewis raced all the way back in go-karts when they were like 10 years old.
Oh, shit.
So they know each other. Maybe, but as far as F1 and being adults.
But sometimes you just gotta shut the fuck up.
Yeah, yeah, exactly.
Yeah, it's like, you just look at him now and it's like just stop talking, man. It's
you're embarrassing yourself. Just shut
you're
up.
Embarrassing yourself.
Yeah. and that is what happened. But okay, so in the race, though, actually, to describe it to you, it was going to, like, after the second stint.
It's hot today. Man.
Yeah.
No, oh man, crazy. I'm
taking off this top shirt.
No, it smells like dudes in here.
I opened the window back up, but
yeah,
no,
there's no breeze or anything.
But anyway, yeah. So towards the end of the race, Rosberg kept basically saying on the radio, like, tell Lewis to speed up, or, you know, and then the radio was like, well, you know, why don't you speed up?
They did ask Lewis to speed up a little bit. No, they but said that, like, that, target 147.3.
But that was after Nico said to them, like, oh, if I go any faster, I'm gonna get into the dirty air and I'm gonna destroy my front tires. Now that there's a reason why that happens, right? So they're both in arguably the same car. There's some debate about that, but right. Basically the same car.
Aside from setup, I think.
Yeah.
The way they have the springs and cambers, it's more to their own feel.
Right. And the track and whatnot, and in the same
all
car.
The nubbins, as they say. the nubbins are the same.
So if he came up to too close to Hamilton, he would be basically trailing him on like this just patch of hot, and they call it dirty air because it's been like it's gone already through all the aero elements of the car, all the wings and whatever.
Right. So it's all turbulent.
Yeah. Instead of being like
turbulent
calm air,
and hot.
Yeah. Ooh. Turbulent and hot, which are no good for the aerodynamics of the next car.
Right.
If you're the car in front that has clean air, whatever, it doesn't matter.
Smells like burnt gasoline.
Yeah. Oh yeah. But.
It's better like than smell. It's got better than regular gasoline, but, I suppose.
Go-kart smell is fucking amazing. I love it.
Yeah. No, that's just kind of weird. I do like the smell of matches though.
Matches are pretty cool. Yeah. Phosphorus, yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, anyways.
Yeah, but anyway, so yeah, so but then he kept arguing like, "Oh, you know, whatever." And then eventually they did tell Lewis to speed up, and when he got that order, he was like, okay, and just went with it, and like got right. so far ahead.
Whatever time they said, like target 147.3, whatever the number was, they were telling him like speed your lap up a bit, and he hit that target almost dead on. Like he just sped up a bit and almost hit exactly what they wanted, Jesus. Not faster or slower. Yeah, it was pretty cool. Max Verstappen's car failed. I think we started talking about this just before the call there.
Yeah.
But his car failed catastrophically, almost right by the finish line. Those marshals there had a bit of trouble getting his car off the track.
That was funny to see, man.
They're trying to basically like push it back and basically just like turn the wheel, and they opened the fence and tried to push it off
track.
They
clearly had very little, if any, experience at all with dealing with this situation. So like they didn't turn the wheels enough, or that they just didn't do it in, like. Enough.
Point turn trying to parallel park.
And towards the end, they just like kept jamming it and broke part of the front wing.
Yeah, they crashed the front wing twice, actually.
Yeah.
And then the team like ran out, and they're not allowed to be standing on the pit road during the race.
That's the thing.
Stop touching our car.
Because of regulations, like the team could like, it's not like the team could go out of the pits and rescue the car themselves. No, they are.
Up to the volunteers on track, whoever's there.
Yeah, they're told not to whoever's closest on to safety the accident. Grounds or something. But
so,
yeah.
So how many of them were fired?
Not or something. Didn't remember
being a race marshal is a volunteer position, so
yeah, not or getting fired. Remember,
what?
He wasn't streaking, but remember there was a dude who ran from the stand. I think it was in qualifying.
It was practice three.
P3. Okay. Yeah. I don't remember exactly when it was, but a dude ran down from the grandstand, somehow got through the fence. And ran across the front straight of the track while the cars were running.
Yeah.
What?
I forget again which I have like the practice usually on in the background when I'm like just around my house. But if somebody was coming down the street and had to kind of almost swerve to miss him, he got arrested and went to jail. Who knows where he went?
Holy shit.
Chinese jail, which probably isn't great.
He's probably dead.
He's had his last Tsing Tao if he was drunk. He must have been drunk to do that. Like, holy shit. Well,
apparently, what he said is that he misunderstood, and he thought that, free practice meant that anybody could come. And, like, so in his defense, he said, like, oh, I was just going to go there and see if they would let me drive a Ferrari.
What the fuck?
I didn't see any. How old was it? They interviewed him?
No. But this is just like what
in the newspaper.
Yeah. this guy was like, oh, like he looked old. Like he looked like in his 40s or 50s.
Oh, Jesus, Murphy. Some people.
But anyway, a lot happened. You know what?
That's hilarious.
I think you should go out of your way and actually watch the race. It was a very, very cool race.
Okay, I'll check it out.
Way too much to talk about. Like, you need a page of notes, but the start of the race was pretty cool. There's a couple teammates bumping, guys bouncing off each other, and again, a couple cars falling back, a couple cars jumping ahead.
That Kimi Raikkonen start was intense.
His start was great. Finally got to see him race Vettel for real.
Pastor Maldonado.
Oh my God. Yeah, we almost forgot to talk about him.
Wait,
yeah.
Did he crash again?
Three times.
He
almost lost control. Then he lost control.
And going into the pits.
Then he crashed. Yeah,
Do you know how I remember this guy's name? Is that rhyme that you made up for him?
Crash door?
Yeah, no, it's
the Maldozer.
There's more than one.
Yeah, the worst driver of all time.
Oh my God, yeah. As soon as you mentioned his name, I was like, oh, what? Did he crash again?
Yeah. That's
what I noticed this weekend, though? There's a lot of spring noise. I noticed this weekend, and I must have subconsciously seen it a bunch of times, but it didn't click until now, is that he's number 13. That's what he chose to paint on the side of his car. He chose number 13.
So, yeah,
what's
no
wrong
wonder.
With 13?
Well, unlucky 13. I'm not superstitious, but, you know.
I love the number 13. It's my favorite number.
Oh, there you go.
I got a roof for him now.
Start cheering for a pastor. He came around, I forget what corner again, but he was sideways, went through the dirt. With his sideways, with his foot down, you could tell because as soon as he hit the dirt, he spun up a cloud of glass. He had his foot in the pedal. Going into the pits, he lost control. And kind of like people were complaining that there was a little runoff area that was sand before and they paved it for this year. And cars were using that to get more speed into the pit lane. He hit that and went off. Like...
And so I think it was like
he was just done.
No. Okay, but before that, on that same thing, when he like sort of like overshot his entry to the pits.
Yeah,
I remember like because I listened to the those guys, the Five Lights guys, their podcast.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like one of them made a very like a funny remark, and it's true that because after that, the message on the pits to him was like basically like. All right, Pastor. Do we need another front wing? They're just resigned to like. All right, do we need another front wing? Like,
looks like
how's the car? Like, in that occasion, he didn't actually like hit the wall, so he was fine. But when he actually got into a crash, was Jensen Button, and Jensen actually got a penalty.
For 5 seconds.
I think it was just like 3 points in his license and a slap
on
the wrist.
He did. He got a time penalty.
Oh, like just added to like his final result, right?
Because he didn't have time to. He would have stopped during the race.
Right.
To his time, and I'm not 100% if it dropped him down or not. I didn't get a chance to look into that.
Yeah.
But he got 3 points on his license.
Yeah. But basically, like, it, even though it was. Jensen's fault. Why was he all the way down there competing with Jensen on the Lotus? Like that was clearly his fault for going into the pits and missing that pit
entry.
Yeah,
that he was in seventh, eighth, or ninth place when that happened.
Yeah.
It dropped him back so much. Again, the marshals had to come out and push him back. So it sort of helped him out a bit, or whatever happened. He lost a lot of time on that.
I don't know who the accountant is for Lotus, but I mean the money that he's bringing in it can't be
at this
enough,
point.
Man.
It can't be
it
worth
can't
it.
Can't be yeah. worth it.
At this point, no. It's got to be a lot of money. But he's Venezuelan, right?
Yeah.
So he was getting what's the guy? The cancer that Chavez, right?
Yeah, Chavez was a
Chavez
big supporter.
Was backing him, right? Yeah. I don't know. I'm not sure. Okay.
I just have a bit
we'll
of
stay off that Chavez
a small question in cool. terms of standings and all that.
Right.
And so I'm looking at the standings right now, and it looks like it's like a Hamilton, Vettel, and Rosberg.
Right.
Top three.
Yes.
And if it's going the way I think this season is going to be going, it's those guys.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah.
We got Massa, so Raikkonen, Bottas, and...
They say that... Joe Sayward... I've talked about him before. He's a preeminent F1 journalist. He said that pretty much the way things are by Spain or at the end of the Spanish Grand Prix weekend,
yeah.
it's pretty much going to stay like that on and off for the rest of the year, or at least like you get to see like how
things
are
like a big thing,
right? Or I mean, and there's gonna be battles here and there, but like, but things are gonna be like, you know, like the top players, whoever is like up in the top five, then it's probably gonna be the same for the rest of the year, and it's been pretty much like that on average.
Okay,
and again, it's too many. Not the sport with numbers is. Yeah, especially when you're in this position we're doing right now. But the I know Mercedes and Ferrari have a similar number of development points left. So at some point there'll be upgrades.
Oh, yeah. Right. Maybe
twice through the year.
Those tokens that we were talking about.
Right. Yeah. Those shiny bits.
Yeah. The magic F1 money somehow.
Yeah. Once or maybe twice, each engine will be upgraded at some point this year, and who knows what those could bring.
Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. It was a good.
That's
weekend.
Really exciting.
Just before we get off the topic, we've been ragging on Maldonado a lot, but really, like, his three crashes weren't his fault this year. Like, he got the first race, first corner, he got smashed off the track.
Yeah, but like I said with the Button thing, I mean, nothing about Button. Everybody knows that McLaren is in a bad situation right now, so there are
Button's fault.
Right.
That was all. But Pastor had nothing to do with
that. Yeah, but if he hadn't fucked up before in the pit entry and in other occasions,
that's true.
He wouldn't have been down there. You know what I mean?
You're right. He would have been up in the top 10.
So it may not have been his fault intrinsically. But anyway, I have a theory about this because when I was...
You sold his soul to the devil?
No.
Damn it.
The devil wouldn't want him. He's too ugly. One of the things that the F1 commentators are either on the F1 show or like on the post race or pre race, I don't know, whatever. So, one of the guys in Sky, but either Johnny Herbert or Martin Brundle, I don't remember who, was saying that maybe he's won a race, and we've seen him qualify like pretty high up there.
That race he won was. I remember that.
Yeah, it was crazy.
When was that?
Spain 2012, I think.
2012.
Oh,
yeah.
Shit. Yeah. So anyway,
it's got potential.
Well, that's what everybody thought. But anyway.
Yeah.
But it seems to be an awareness thing, and I think that he maybe gets loses focus. And actually, I do remember, and I actually went back and saw a couple of the driver's press conferences that he's been in, especially like the past couple of years, but the years before, or actually even last year. Anyway, I saw, and like, so he's, they all get water bottles or whatever. Like, I do remember one of them. I think I pointed it to you when we were watching it live last year.
Trying to remember.
Yeah, and he's like, he just, like, pass me that water, that Evian water bottle.
Sure.
So he's got it here, and like because people weren't asking him questions, so he kind of got like
he got all fidgety and shit.
Yeah, and he was doing like he was like rolling it on the table at one point and doing this, and you know, just playing with it. And what that reminded me of was
a 5-year-old
myself.
Oh,
look what I'm doing right now. Yeah. I'm the same way, man. I always have to have. There's got to be if I'm not something in my hand. My knees bouncing.
Yeah.
Or I'm like,
yeah, no, I'm the same way.
Fidgeting my toe or something.
Yeah.
That's how I got your Bic later the other day.
But I got ADHD, right?
Yeah.
Maybe that's it. Maybe Pastor's problem is that he just has ADHD and he shouldn't be racing because, you know, let's be honest, you need all the focus you can get to operate an F1 car. And if you have something like ADHD or low latent inhibition,
right?
And it's bad.
I think if you're at that point, there's no. If you're in a Formula One being paid millions of dollars, you're fine.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? He just needs, I don't know what it is. I can't guide him in his journey through F1. But if I were somewhat involved, I'd be like, yo, just chill out.
Yeah, but you can't chill out. You just, I think I have some sort of milder version
okay,
of,
so
the same,
ADHD
of the same thing.
ADHD is
though,
attention
like,
deficit disorder, or ADHD is a hyper.
Attention
deficit
/ hyperactivity.
Right, but that's a deficit.
There's being right? some.
So what I'm saying is that you have the attention still. It's not like it left. You're just putting it into something else. Like, you know what I mean? Like
I think it's a blanket term for many, many, many things. Yeah,
totally.
Yeah. Yeah, it's more like. Fuck. It's hard to describe.
You
but
just
it's
like the fucking fidget with shit. Like, it's not a big fucking deal. Like,
but it's more like. like a description I've heard of it is that your brain doesn't tell you not to do things as much as most other people get told by their own brain not to do things that might be inappropriate or damaging or right. like my palm is red from I've been playing with this thing since I opened this bottle. My right. palm's red because
right. You know I mean? Yeah, but I think everyone does that shit.
To a certain degree.
Yeah. You like, see your palms? Show me your hands. Yeah, maybe that might be because relatedly...
Maybe it's too much for him.
Relatedly, I think it was Ricciardo the other day. They were asking him about his badass start that he had where he came along the wall and he was saying like, yeah, you have... Or it might have been Rosberg. Again, like my brain's a mess this week. He was saying that you sort of like you see the cars beside you when they're in front of you and as you're passing them and you just sort of, your brain sort of like calculates where they are when you're going into the corners. And
right.
Yeah, maybe yeah, Maldonado's just not, he's just like concentrating on just the wheel or like the narrower focus. I don't know.
Right, but that's not a deficit of attention. He still has it. He's just putting it in the wrong place.
He's got it focused in the wrong spot, man.
Right. It's not a deficit.
Well, like he said, there's so many...
Blankets.
Yeah. He has like a ridiculously strong accent, and I think a lot of people take something away from him for that. Yeah. But when you hear him talk, he speaks perfectly good English, and he has a strong vocabulary, and he seems like a nice guy, too. He's like, he's always willing to talk, like answer any questions.
From what everybody that's in the F1 world says that off the track, and you know, if you just as a person to talk to, he's a wonderful guy.
Mm-hmm. I've never spoken to him, but yeah, just seeing like it's nothing to I think a lot of people just mentally switch his accent or whatever,
right? Ah, you must be slow or something,
yeah. He has braces too, but that's nothing to do with his racing.
Wait, he has braces,
yeah, he does on the bottom still, yeah.
Somehow
that's crazy,
yeah.
I still have mine on the back.
Yeah, I got one of those retainers up forever.
Yeah. I asked my dentist like 2 weeks ago.
I'll have to pick it out of my ashes. that metal bar.
Melt it down and sell it on some sort of like weird black market for dental stuff.
You have to ask your dentist what?
It was just like, hey, can I get this taken out? And then they're just like, no, that's in your face forever.
You can take it out, but your teeth will be crooked.
Yeah, they'll be all fucked up. Yeah. So my dentist actually ended up doing that. She's like, well, I'm a dentist, so I watch over my teeth and wore a retainer at night.
Oh, okay.
But eventually, just during the day,
Yeah.
If you look close, I have like maybe like a fifth or a quarter of a millimeter gap in my front teeth.
Yeah.
And I remember I was sitting
noticed that. I never noticed that.
I got that retainer and I was sitting in my buddy's basement probably 7 or 8 years ago. My buddy Daryl. What's up, Daryl? And, he's like, hey, you want some chocolate? And he gave me this mini chocolate bar that was from his freezer. Oh, I was like, oh, yeah. I had to bite it, and the pressure cracked my retainer. One of the retainer bases broke off. And I was like, I'll fix it later, because I was like 18. I fixed it like 2 weeks later. But within that 2 weeks, that gap was there, and it's permanent now.
Oh, shit. So,
if you ever break your permanent retainer, anybody... Yeah. Go as fast as you can because your teeth will get fucked up really fast. Your parents will be mad at you.
Yeah, well, then you'll feel like a teenager for like another 2 years again.
You'll feel like Pastor Maldonado.
Yeah. Throwback. My parents paid for my braces. I never told them that, and they never noticed. Don't tell them anybody.
Yeah. I think we're done talking about China now. Let's move to Bahrain.
Yeah,
let's
China go to Bahrain. Awesome. Let's move to Bahrain.
Oh, yeah. You gotta say it with an accent.
Bahrain.
That's how you say it.
According to what that chick, what was her name? Amber Lyon?
Amber Lyon.
I know her.
And all the Bahrainis.
And everybody that lives there. Come on.
Bahrainians. Bahrainis? I don't know. What's the...
Bahraini, I think. I'm gonna call them Bahrainis. So that sounded right.
Bahraini sounds
I'm gonna
right.
call them Baruchians. Just the thing I made up.
Baruchians. I'll stick by it, you know.
Thanks, Javier. I'm going to need you in my time of crisis. Anyway, sorry.
The Bahrain Grand Prix. It used to be a daytime race, but now it's the sunset race. The twilight race.
I was reading the Wikipedia page about it. I didn't realize they put up those lights for the 10th anniversary of the race.
Oh, yeah.
The 10th running.
Yeah.
10th anniversary.
It's so much better, man. It's so much better at night.
Yeah, it looks cool. I drove it in the Formula One game.
Oh, no,
it didn't do that. It just started at night because I was doing time trials. Yeah,
Bahrain is like that. There's only the one sunset. I would.
Is Bahrain like fully at night?
Yeah. Yes, Marina. Abu Dhabi is the sunset.
Oh, shit. I got it all wrong.
Abu Dhabi transition. They do it in the evening. But I would bet, I don't know for sure, but I would bet that the UAE has a lock on keeping that race as the only sunset race.
Probably.
There's more than one night race now.
It's a lot of egos around those oil-rich countries, for sure.
Singapore should have done the same on the night race because theirs looks so much better. That city is like made of lights. Yeah. Singapore?
Yeah, Singapore is crazy though, but I think that Bahrain has benefited from that transition from a daytime to a nighttime race, and the cars look fantastic. And I watched FP1 and FP2 this morning.
Yeah.
So FP1, because
goddamn unemployed fun-employed guy.
Fun-employed.
Last week I would have been doing the same.
The thing is that the FP1 happens actually because of the time that it has to happen. Mm-hmm. And Friday there's FP1 and FP2. They're 2 hours apart. FP1 happened during the day, basically. Mm. And the temperature of the track was so much hotter than it would have.
Almost pointless.
Yeah, it was. It's basically like it's the least representative practice session of the whole year was this FP1, and it's gonna be this FP1. So there was some running, and I took some notes. But basically what happened in FP1 this morning wasn't much. It wasn't much that was significant. Mm. Let's put it that way. Mercedes did a few long runs just to presumably to actually to test the limits of their tires, but they didn't put any fast times. Like the faster times were.
I was hiding in the washroom at work, and I tried to open the A stream around 8 or 9 o'clock. All right, I gotta see if I could watch like 1 or 2 minutes of this. But like I told you guys, I'm working on like too high up in the air that there's not enough cell phone signal.
Trying to organize like when we're doing this, and Danny would get back to us and like 5 hours after the text was sent.
Yeah.
And he was like, wait, you didn't get the text? He's like, oh, no, man, I'm working like in the air.
Right? And I'm like 200 meters. You could probably see out the window here, like where. There's some trees there. It's the like 200 meters
that
up.
The breeze was fantastic.
It's the tallest building in Canada.
What? It is right now.
Yeah. Which one? First Canadian Place.
First Canadian Place. It was the tallest building in the Commonwealth for decades until 2 years ago, 3 years ago.
Whenever they put up the Shard, I think.
Shard. Yeah. I don't know if it's still, I think it still might be the biggest. I think it's bigger than the Shard. Like
in terms of like square space?
Square meterage, floor space. There's like 19 elevators or something, like almost 20 elevators in that building. It's crazy.
It's a ridiculous building.
You go like, this one goes from 1 to 46, even floors only. This one goes from 46 to 72, odd floors only, like this bank. There's four banks, and then there's a service bank that's separate. It's insane, man. It's insane. They go fast, too. Like, you feel some G's going up and down.
What button was out?
In
FP1 due to engine problems.
Oh my god!
Yeah, and he was out within 20 minutes of FP2. Also, engine problems.
I wonder how before the season, how many engines Honda built? They must have built more than 8.
Oh, for sure.
They used a few in quali, I guess, in the preseason.
It's pretty much a known fact that they're bracing themselves for this. Just their penalty points are coming, and they're gonna come in a big way. And I think they've
sacrificed this year to testing. They've been out for years, but I'm so confident in their reliability and performance. I've driven a bunch of Civics. I had like 5 or 6. Okay, I had, I think, 6 Honda Civics, and 4 of them were over 400,000 kilometers. One of them was over 500, and one was over 600,000 kilometers. Shit. So the reliability potential is there. It is there.
Oh,
oh my God, I better drink faster.
I remember that when the announcement came out a couple of years ago, I was still living in Windsor, I guess.
Which announcement?
That Honda was
considering for sure. coming back?
No, when they announced that they were coming back.
Okay.
I remember one of the other guys that that worked at my office. He was also an F1 fan, and he said, like, you know what?
Thank you.
If anything, there's reasons to be excited about this, because from the road car business, we know that Honda can build a mighty V6. And yeah. and you know, the V6 were coming and this and that. I think that there's much more to come from McLaren Honda. They just got to get a few things sorted out. But when they do, it's
on.
Yeah, it really is.
They're starting to show some pace. Well, except for the flames and smoke that keeps happening. They're starting to show some real pace, for real.
Oh, yeah. And, what's his name? The team principal. His name is Eric Bouye. He said that by mid-season, they expect to be midfielders. So that's their target. They're hoping to be up there, fighting there. And if they can ride that all to, like, say, not necessarily challenge for wins consistently, but maybe get into like a top five positions by the end of the year. I think next year we're gonna see it's on. If they can get to the top five by the end of this year.
Yeah. Well, I don't know about top five. Yeah. That seems like stretching it, but yeah, I'm confident for next year. And I think in two, like maybe. Again, like 2017 is so. If there wasn't this looming change happening, I would bet that they would be selling their engines by 2017. But it's gonna be too much uncertainty. Like, it sucks for Honda. But Bernie, there in the past few days, there's been a deluge, like a huge amount, an avalanche of articles talking about going back to V8s. That's what Bernie wants.
But it's yeah, not.
All I can do is close my eyes and shake my head slowly.
It's not the answer. I mean, even though I would love that, and I'm sure everybody, you know, if going to the races and looking at it and watching it live and whatnot, because there's a level of spectacle that comes with these roaring V8s or V10s or whatever.
Yeah.
But
it's loud, man. It's intense for anyone that's been to a race before 2014.
Yeah, it is crazy. It's
awesome. I'm really excited for Montreal, man. No,
Montreal is gonna be awesome this year.
Not that it's not still awesome.
Yeah,
but the sound you need earmuffs, like good ones.
Before
it's that loud. Before, but now it's fine.
Yeah,
I'll live my ear. Yeah. I need my earballs.
Yeah, you need your ear. Oh yeah, you're like a musician or something.
Yeah. Oh, funny enough, the show I was playing on Friday.
Oh yeah.
I wear my. My headphones.
But they're not connected to anything, right?
Yeah, they're not connected to anything. And I couldn't fucking hear, me and Marcus couldn't hear anything on stage.
Oh, yeah.
And we're just,
you don't
playing.
Have monitors there?
We do, but we didn't have a...
Oh, because the normal sound guy wasn't there or something.
No, it was someone else.
Yeah, I remember talking to you. And I was drunk as fuck.
And so, like, we start playing, and I was like, oh, no. And I had to yank him out of my ears, and it took me a while because I was trying to play, and then I was like, oh, nope. Nope. But yeah,
it sounded good in the crowd anyway.
Yeah, that's
people,
everyone keeps on telling me that.
Jumping around.
I loved it
on stage. I couldn't fucking. It sounded so weird. Anyway,
you're like
so
in the middle of it.
Yeah.
Listen to bamboo.com.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Listen to bamboo.com.
We got some things in the works. We have a music video coming out soon.
Oh, yeah.
It's going through.
I keep
on saying this, but it's going through its renditions.
What song can you say?
The video?
What can I say?
Oh,
the video.
I was asking, can you say what song it is?
Yeah. So it's going to be for that song.
Fitting. All right, cool.
Yeah, cool.
We didn't play that song at the show, though.
No, you didn't. But you did.
Like, remember when you tried to convince me I did?
No.
Or we did?
No.
Oh, okay.
Wow. I was actually drunk as fuck.
Well, I appreciate it. The next day. Remember when we were talking to Mike outside? He's like, what?
What?
But then I did, and I got that flash. And apparently, you guys got to see this band.
Oh yeah,
not quite.
Oh,
whatever, man.
Oh no, that ended up being very cool, in its own right.
It's feedback that's important.
Yeah. No, it was fantastic.
At any stage of life, kind of totally. Feedback is like it's good. It points
the fact
in the right
that
direction.
Someone was willing to come and talk to us was fantastic. So
cool. Yeah. Hey, hey, big no. Big honestly, I mean, if you're anywhere near the Toronto area, when's your next show? For CMW, right?
CMW, it's a Thursday.
Canadian Music Week.
Yeah, we play at the Velvet Underground at 12 p.m.
Legendary Toronto venue.
Or 12 a.m. Yeah. Something like that. Yeah. Some, and then we play North by Northeast.
Which is another Toronto institution.
It's a huge festival.
Huge.
Make it out to see Bamboo. Honestly, like they are, as much as you might like their tracks on their website, again, listen to bamboo.com. Seeing them live is an otherworldly, almost religious experience. Especially when you're drunk as fuck.
Oh, yeah. No, it's a lot of fun. We have a lot of fun. You know what's weird? It's like one of my favorite... Like, one of my intentions with the band, and it's my own personal one, is that whenever I see live music, I always go home, that especially if it's, like, really good in its own right, and I always feel inspired to do whatever I want. And if I can sort of, in any shape or form, instill that into the people who listen to my band's music, then that's fucking... That's what I want to do.
What Richard said, actually, during and after the show... Not that you guys weren't good before. But he's like, God, like he saw you a few months ago at
the Gladstone.
Oh, that's
the Gladstone
right.
Hotel.
Yeah.
He said, like, God damn, these guys have gotten better, man. Yeah. Not that you weren't.
Well, that Gladstone good show, like that was also bad sound. But I'm not gonna.
Yeah,
make
they're not really like known for putting on live shows.
No, not, that's true. That's
whereas,
true.
Like, the Horseshoe or the Silver Dollar. That's what right, that's what they do.
Yeah,
that's what you go there for.
Anyway, let's go back to F1 and Bahrain.
Yeah, let's do it. Sorry about that.
No. Sorry about that. But it's just let's bring it back to F1 to finish on Bahrain. Bahrain. What your thoughts on the track?
I like it, man. I do. I don't know. From like video games or whatever, I've driven it. It's fun. Yeah. There's a lot of overtaking opportunities. The hard corner, going onto like the middle straight. Downhill and sort of like two sort of left-handers downhill. Catches you out every time. I was surprised looking at the Wikipedia page. They built that track for $150 million.
Slave labor. Labor.
Yeah. I wasn't going to say it. But you look at like the American track, the Circuit of the Americas, over $400 million.
Oh, Jesus.
Malaysia, we talked about last week, was something like $400 million, $350. Like these are expensive venues.
God damn.
Off camera, you asked, you actually were wondering something that somebody tweeted at this morning during practice. You said, why don't they use the longer circuit that endurance racing does?
Well, I didn't say why, but I thought that I remembered that they had used it before.
Yeah. In Bruno Senna, because Bruno
Senna,
the track
that they do use is awesome, I don't remember the longer version.
Yeah, so the longer version. I guess this tweet came up, and Bruno Senna was immediately like, "Cause it sucks, cause it's he's like, yeah, it's
the extra corners are kind of thrown in there."
Well, it just he says it proved to be like I'm assuming like in theory like it would have been good, but it proved to be no good for overtaking, and it was just. It wasn't good for F1. It just like for that type of
far
racing,
far fewer laps.
Yeah,
the heat, I guess, on the tires. They do use it for a WEC though.
But those are way racing. Longer races.
Yeah, exactly. And a totally different style of racing.
Yeah, in different cars, all kinds of different cars. Anyway,
I don't think tire wear is nearly as important in WEC. Yeah. They use like a harder tires that last longer.
Yeah.
One thing I was surprised at was that. China was in danger of possibly being canceled. There was some government corruption stuff we talked about last week.
Oh, yeah.
But the attendance was low. And that for the event of MotoGP in China, they had attracting over 250,000 people to the track. The capacity for Bahrain is 70,000. And they're running. But I guess that's because they have some sort of royal family that's just bankrolling the whole thing.
The
Saudi prince...
Yeah, well,
no,
it's
pay
for all the gas. The Bahraini royal family.
Sorry, not Saudi. The Bahraini,
whatever the monarchy is.
Yeah, whatever the king or whatever. He commissioned the building of this track just to like outbid the other Middle Eastern countries, I guess.
He's like, do it.
It's the first Middle Eastern GP was in Bahrain.
Oh, okay.
Also, they have, through some arrangement, they own part of McLaren, actually.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I didn't know that.
The Bahraini
royal family?
Yeah.
Jesus. I didn't know that.
That's crazy. Or like I guess like through like the country of Bahrain, you know, something like that.
And something else that goes along with the price of this track at $150 million, how did they get it done for that, is they use something for the track surface, which also was used at Yas Marina, which is called gray whack aggregate, which comes from a quarry in England.
Oh, yeah.
From Shropshire. I made a note of this.
Actually, you know what? It's funny that you mentioned that, because Ted Kravitz this morning, an FP2,
talking about that?
You know, he was talking about like, or actually, like, I think it was Crofty that brought it up. Like, oh, didn't they bring like something from England over here? And then
all of the asphalt.
Ted actually said at the wrong place, but then he was like, okay, no, I know that it's probably not that place, but I just like to say the name of that place. I think it
Shropshire.
No. The wrong place that he thought it was like Lundum or something. I don't know.
Apparently, apparently Yas Marina has the same aggregate, but somehow they shipped like 5 kilometers. The actual full distance, 5.412 kilometers, is the F1 circuit, and if you include the endurance circuit, is over 6 kilometers. And there's still some other runoffs in the pits. Jesus. All of it's paved with this aggregate. Like, think how many stones you would need to pave this room.
Yeah,
like, the asphalt is probably 4 to 6 inches thick.
Yeah,
because it's a track that's supposed to last 50 or 100 years.
Yeah.
So
fucking nuts.
A ship full of rocks from England.
Yeah. I guess so. That's where like the 50 million.
150
million. 150
million.
Yeah. Yeah, the rest was just
free.
Was like you like they just went like rounded up everybody in Bahrain and is like, you do or die.
Yeah.
Like, oh, like you do or die. No, you do this or you die.
It's sort of, especially 2 years ago and not so much last year. Maybe in 3 years ago, I guess, especially, that sort of this protesting in Bahrain has overshadowed the race a bit. They had like violent protests with the police shooting at crowds and stuff. They're protesting the royal family's treatment of the...
Well, a couple of years ago,
it was canceled.
It was canceled.
It was two. I think maybe 2 years missed, at least one.
Due to security concerns.
Yeah. Oh, shit. I'm looking up where it is right now.
Yeah, well, the main problem seems to be that, I forget what it is, but you know how there's two main splits in Muslimhood in Islam. There's some that are Shia and the Sunnis. And the monarchy and the royal family and everybody that's nobility and everybody that's in high position and all the rich people in Bahrain are one, and the regular people are the other. So it's one of those things.
Oh, God.
Yeah.
I think we said this before the show, that Bahrain is a small country.
Yeah, I'm looking at it right now, and it's fucking tiny.
Yeah, it's like the size of the Toronto area. Like,
yeah, pretty much.
In square kilometers.
Oh, it's, motherfucker. Okay, it's so they really, got that. Really small. They got that. What the fuck is it? It looks crazy. I'm going to throw it up here. It's got this thing.
Oh yeah,
it's like that resort thing. That's
they all have that. Just these islands, that man-made islands.
What is it made out of? Like the bodies of people? Like the people who are like, I don't want to work on the track. They're like, oh, we got a place for you, buddy. Yeah.
Oh my God.
Okay.
Us three are officially banned from the country of Bahrain.
Oh,
we cannot go in there. They will decapitate us.
I'm not surprised.
One of my really, really good friends growing up was from Bahrain. I remember probably the third or fourth grade. We had these portables at my school. Like, you know, there's like basically like a temporary classroom.
Mm-hmm.
It's supposed to be temporary. They never built an extension on my school, so I was out there for a few years. This guy, Dwayne, came to Canada. So we were probably 8 or 9 years old. And I remember he is the only person I've seen that was his first time seeing snow. And
he's like, shit.
What?
This like, is freaking out, yeah. Crazy.
Like from 8 years old, that's one of my only memories from back then.
I had a similar story where a guy from Pakistan who came to college or university at Trent.
Oh, yeah.
And his name was Ali. And we're like, Ali, it's going to snow tonight. He's like,
What is
you,
that?
Are you fucking kidding me? Like, even he loved it. He was just like throwing snowballs and shit.
The first time that you see snow is something that's unreal,
dude.
Holy shit. Yeah, trust me, I've been through it.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, you.
Yeah,
you.
Yeah, exactly.
Coming from Colombia.
Yeah.
I didn't get to witness that one.
Was it as majestic as I think it was?
The first snowfall was kind of a letdown because it was that nasty, like, wet snow that just melted as soon as it hit the ground. But, the first time that the GTA got covered in snow was sick.
Yeah. Oh, that's great.
Dwayne from Bahrain. What's up, Dwayne? I don't know what he's doing these days. I told you, I guess you were there. For my birthday, we went to, what was it called? I don't know, some sort of like fancy-ish restaurant.
Forget it. Yeah.
Whatever.
Oh, we went to Ballroom. No, we didn't.
No.
Whatever.
Anyways, this is like 2 months ago. We're eating dinner. Had a beer or two, had a nice meal. These guys, group of guys sits down at the table beside us. And I said to these guys, I'm like, it has to be Dwayne. It has to be Dwayne. And I was like, no. Like, he was as far away from me as you. So I had like a good view. He's right there.
Yeah.
And I remember like the washroom there was upstairs and you could sort of like look over the restaurant. I went up there and I was like, man,
we went to West Lodge.
West Lodge, okay. West Lodge. I couldn't remember the name of the place. I looked, I was like, that's Dwayne. So we finished eating, paid our bill, like you're getting up. And I went over and I was like, is your name Dwayne? And he looked at me like, what the fuck? I was like, man, I thought for sure you were this dude that I went to school with. Dwayne from Bahrain.
Wherever you are,
it wasn't him.
Aww.
He's like married now. Who knows where he is?
Yeah,
he's like. Yeah.
Do we have anything else on Bahrain?
I got one more. Something else I learned when I was reading a bit about the track is before it was built, everyone was thinking like we even saw in Australia in the first race, it's fall there when the season starts.
Mm.
The track gets covered in dry leaves. The leaves fall off in the fall. Oh, track's shit. Covered in leaves. You see some tracks like, I don't know, not China so much, but Korea was like this where they don't get used throughout the year, so they accumulate dust and just dirt. And then for the first two practices, like the track, you can tell it's dirty and just dust is flying up. And it sort of gets cleaned up with the 20 cars whipping around and the other series racing.
Let's not forget that this track is in, like, it's as much of Bahrain in the middle of the desert.
The desert, yeah.
The desert.
This is the exact point I'm getting to.
The desert.
This was the concern of the FIA and, I guess, whatever other racing bodies when it was originally proposed and being built. This track's going to be covered in sand. Like, how are we supposed to race there?
You know what? Actually, sorry to interrupt you, Danny, but one thing to that point, before I forget, because I just remembered, Bruno Senna also said that apparently, I don't know if this is true or not, but apparently he heard that they spray the sand.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was getting at.
Go for it.
Well, yeah, you said it. Around the whole track is sand. As far as you can see, it's just sand. And they sprayed it down with glue, with some sort of adhesive. They went around and sprayed. I'm not sure how many meters outside or around the track they sprayed, but they coated the whole thing with glue to hold it down.
Fucking nuts.
To hold it down.
They glued the desert around the track.
Yeah. That's how ridiculous F1 is. Mike, I'm trying to tell you.
Yeah, man. This is the pinnacle of motorsport. Like, I am sure.
When you
Yeah. We have double when confirmation.
When you say glue, like, I'm thinking of like white glue.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Like
that probably that shit that kids used to like glue like
horse
construction
bones.
Paper.
And then one kid just fucking ate with a spoon.
Oh my god.
They got a couple of guys out there with Uhu sticks just pasting down all the. Okay, we need you to paste all of the sand.
All of it.
All of it.
Yeah. Uh huh.
I know it's a big track, but.
I believe in you.
You got a whole box of glue here. The whole case of Uhu sticks. You turn the bottom to push it up when you get low.
Oh my god. If you run out, there's more. All right, there's more. Oh.
Yeah, man. Bahrain.
Bahrain, man.
Qualifying.
Javier's dying.
Yeah, he's dying.
No, sorry, guys. This is just residual sickness. It's not actual sickness.
I don't believe that.
I'm not sick anymore.
Yeah,
sounds like you're sick.
We were supposed to do this like whatever 2 days ago. I called you. I could hear it in your voice.
For sure.
Yeah.
And then, like, instead of, like, a sane person and taking the subway or transit, he's like, you know what? I'm going to bike there.
Yeah, man. It was, like, the first day.
It was gorgeous outside.
It is. Yeah, it still is. And it was the first day, like, of this week, pretty much, that I left. Or in 4 days that I left my apartment. So,
jeez,
I had
what'd
to
do
it
all day. What'd you do?
X-Files?
X-Files is almost.
No, I already finished the X-Files. Don't worry about that. For Monday through Wednesday, I mostly spend like in bed, like dying.
Oh my god! Yeah,
like I said, man, it's beautiful. It looks like fucking summer outside. They said I walked here from Dundas and Spadina just cause, man. Yeah. Like it was about an hour.
You could.
Beautiful. Yeah. Beautiful, man.
Excellent. And now we're gonna go. We're gonna wrap it up and hang
let's
outside.
Finish the second sink towel.
Oh my god! Yeah, let's go drink beer outside. And if it's wherever you are listening to us from, if it's nice out, go drink a beer outside. It's awesome.
Yeah.
Next week.
Even if it's sunny California, just go outside. Yeah. Appreciate it for us.
Yeah. Yeah.
Next week, I know the last two, last week was cool. This week, we had problems. The week before, we had some unlucky problems. Next week, I'm going on vacation, but I'm going to do my very best. I'm going to
participate somehow.
Yeah, I'm going to a country that probably doesn't have the most reliable internet connections, but
that's all right.
I'm going to do whatever I can to Skype in, whatever. Well, it might be my voice. You're probably not going to see my face.
Yeah.
Not enough bandwidth for the whole video spectrum.
One thing that I did here and on
actually,
on today's
it's going to be probably 2 weeks I'm gone, but
hang on. Yo. It's apparently they were saying that there might be a sandstorm in some way or another, or at least a mild.
That's what I was
tomorrow, maybe around qualifying. So, it might be
things
tomorrow.
Could be shaken up.
Yeah. Yeah.
Darude.
Play us out.
Darude.
Let's go outside.
And then let's listen to Darude.
I'm down for that. I can do that.
All right, guys. See you next week.
Thank you.
Enjoy
Thank
the
you.
Race. Enjoy the Bahraini race.